In 2017, something seismic happened at a lab inside Google. A team published a paper called "Attention is All You Need." They introduced a new architecture that would change artificial intelligence forever, the Transformer. Back then, it looked like a clever advance for translation and language tasks. What almost no one realized was that this was the spark for a global AI revolution. Chatbots, AI agents, image and video generators, and generative AI as we know it, all trace back to that one idea: attention at scale. That same architecture powers modern large language models, the systems now competing to answer our questions, write our code, and increasingly run our digital lives. In late 2022, a small lab in San Francisco pushed out a simple website with a chat box and a name, ChatGPT. Within weeks, the internet was full of screenshots: teachers, students, coders, CEOs. Everyone was testing the limits of a chatbot built on top of Google's own invention. Investors called it an iPhone moment. Inside Google, they called it something else: Code Red. Suddenly, people were asking a brutal question. How did the company that invented modern AI nearly get overtaken at its own game? By the end, you'll be able to answer one question for yourself. Is this the end of OpenAI's lead, or the start of Google's AI awakening? AI isn't new. It's been through booms and winters since the 1950s. Big promises, bigger disappointments, funding cuts, repeat. When Demis Hassabis left Cambridge in the late 90s, it was an AI winter. But he wasn't interested in chatbots or clever demos. He wanted a tool for science, something that could help humans understand reality itself.
I just felt that intelligence and therefore artificial intelligence was the most fascinating thing one could work on. But I sort of thought that we needed another helping hand, like a tool that could help us human scientists understand the world better around us. And that for me was obvious to me from the beginning when I was a teenager that it would be AI. And it would be not only the most powerful tool to help us do science, but the most interesting thing to develop in itself.
DeepMind was born in London, not Silicon Valley. And this was done on purpose. Demis liked that the UK had the Alan Turing Institute, Babbage, and a deep science culture, not 1,000 copy-paste apps chasing ad dollars.
The UK has always been very strong in science and innovation. We punch well above our weight. There's also obviously a rich history in computers with Charles Babbage and Alan Turing. So I feel we're trying to carry on in that tradition. There was a lot of talent trained by these top places that, unless they wanted to go and work for a hedge fund or something in the city in finance, they wanted to do something really intellectually challenging. There aren't that many companies doing that kind of stuff in the UK, or actually in Europe, really. So I felt that we could gather a lot of talent together very quickly that was probably being underutilized in Europe, and that's how it transpired. But the second reason was that I think AI is so important. It's going to affect the whole world. Obviously, you've heard me talk about in the film that, you know, I think it's going to be one of the most important things ever invented. I felt that needs an international sort of approach and cooperation around what we want to do with this technology. It's going to affect everyone in all countries. So I think it needs to be built with more voices and stakeholders than just sort of 100 square miles of California, you know, in Silicon Valley. And also beyond technologists and the scientists just building it. I think it needs social scientists, economists, psychologists, governments, academia, all to be involved in defining how this enormously transformative technology should go.
While Silicon Valley chased clicks, DeepMind chased general intelligence. Systems that could learn anything from scratch, such as playing Atari, Go, and StarCraft using trial and error. In 2014, Google bought DeepMind, not for a product, but for a direction. In parallel, another Google team was quietly rewiring how machines understand language. They dropped the Transformer in 2017, a new way for models to attend to different parts of sentences at once, instead of plodding through word by word. At the time, it looked like just another research paper. In hindsight, it was the split second before a moment that would redefine the world as we know it. In November 2022, OpenAI releases ChatGPT, a friendly chat interface on top of a Transformer-based model, and suddenly the whole world is talking to AI. 100 million users in a matter of weeks. Teachers, lawyers, coders, kids. People are using ChatGPT to pass exams, write essays, debug code, and even brainstorm startup ideas. Google, who had dominated search for 2 decades, watched something terrifying. Instead of Googling questions, people quickly began to ask ChatGPT. While Google embedded transformers into search and translation, OpenAI scaled them into giant general-purpose models. GPT-2 was impressive. GPT-3 was scary. But it was ChatGPT, a simple chat interface over GPT 3.5, that broke the internet and instantly made OpenAI a household name. It passed exams, wrote code, drafted contracts, helped kids with homework, terrified teachers, thrilled startup founders, and broke every product roadmap in big tech. For Google, this wasn't theoretical. Search, the product they rely on to print money, suddenly had a new front end. Ask a question and get a full answer instead of 10 blue links and some ads. Overnight, the paper of record for the internet found itself reading stories about a rival model becoming the new front page. Inside Google, leadership declared code red. The threat wasn't just technical, it was existential to their entire business model and existence. If people started going to ChatGPT instead of Google search for answers, the entire ad-funded engine that powers Alphabet could collapse. Sundar Pichai had been telling employees since 2016 that Google would be AI first. Now that motto had to mean something very real, very fast.
You know, in 2016, one of the first things I did as CEO was to say the company should be AI first. To me, we are just getting started in the beginning of what I think would be an extraordinary decade of innovation.
Microsoft pounced first. It invested heavily in OpenAI and wrapped its models into Bing, painting a giant target on Google search. Analysts suddenly talked about a disruption moment for the first time since the smartphone. Was Google too cautious, too slow, or was it just quietly trying not to break the internet while everyone else sprinted? Google's first answer to ChatGPT was Bard, a chatbot based on its Lambda language model. On paper, Lambda was state of the art. In reality, the launch looked rushed.
Google says it's launching its own artificial intelligence-powered chatbot to rival ChatGPT, which mimics human writing on demand.
ChatGPT set the internet on fire when it launched in November. Its incredibly detailed answers have amazed users. It can pass exams, compose poems, even write code. It's seen as game-changing technology. Now Google has rushed to announce its version of ChatGPT. It's called Bard, and it's based on similar technology. Bard seeks to combine the breadth of the world's knowledge with the power, intelligence, and creativity of our large language models.
In its very first public demo, Bard confidently gave the wrong answer about the James Webb Space Telescope. $100 billion in market value evaporated in a day. Behind the scenes, the pressure was real. ChatGPT had set the internet on fire, and the big fear was simple.
This announcement is the latest salvo in a monumental fight between Google and Microsoft, because make no mistake about it, ChatGPT threatens to undermine Google's entire business model. That's because ChatGPT's AI could transform search engines, producing far more tailored and relevant results.
Google had the tech, but for the first time in 20 years, it didn't control the narrative. Bard didn't last long as a brand. In late 2023 and 2024, Google rolled out Gemini, a family of models meant to compete head-on with GPT-4 and beyond. Gemini could reason across text, images, audio, and video. It powered a new standalone app, underpinned search experiments, and was woven into Workspace, Android, YouTube, and Google's cloud platform. Then came the real statement of intent. Gemini 1.5 Pro arrived with an industry-leading 2 million token context window in preview, which is roughly 1.5 million words, 5,000 pages of text, or hours of audio and video, all of which could fit into a single prompt. At the time, OpenAI's GPT-4 Turbo topped out at around 128,000 tokens, and Anthropic's Claude 3 models sat in the 200,000 token range for most users, with select tiers stretching to around the million token mark, still only half of Gemini's maximum context. For the first time in this new AI race, Google wasn't just catching up. On raw context and multimodal capacity, it was overtaking. You could throw entire code bases, multi-hour transcripts, large corporate PDFs, and long videos into one request and have Gemini reason across all of it at once, instead of stitching together short chunks. But there was a catch. Even as the context window made headlines, benchmarks told a more complicated story. On many public leaderboards, Gemini 1.5 Pro was competitive but not clearly ahead, often trading blows with OpenAI and Anthropic, winning some tests, losing others, and still trailing the very top numbers on certain reasoning and accuracy metrics. It felt like Google had finally slammed a fist on the table, but the debate over who's best was still very much open. And then, just as the narrative started to tilt in Google's favor, Gemini set itself on fire.
I think it is a big deal that Google, which is the source of truth for information, is creating fictitious and historically impossible images. For example, depicting the founding fathers as African-American men or Asian women.
Critics called it woke AI. Supporters said it was a clumsy overcorrection from earlier systems that were biased the other way. Even inside Google, Sundar Pichai called the outputs unacceptable and ordered a pause on the feature while teams retuned the model.
The images that Gemini initially generated of Asian Nazis and black founding fathers, you said that was unacceptable. If you look at any pictures of the founding fathers, you're seeing old white men. People are calling this woke AI, and it's not just happening here, it's happening across the industry. How did the model generate something that it never saw?
We are a company which serves products to users around the world, and there are generic questions. For example, people come and say, show me images of school teachers or doctors or nurses. We have people asking this query from Indonesia or the US. Right? How do you get it right for our global user base? Obviously, the mistake was that we over-applied, including cases where it should have never applied. So that was the bug, and you know, we got it wrong.
Underneath the memes and outrage was a serious question. Who decides what reality models are allowed to show, and what happens when they get it wrong at scale?